encouraging word for us. Yes, be bold and strong. Banish fear and doubt. For remember, the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Holy Spirit, remind us that God's promise is everlasting throughout all our lives. You know how fickle we are, O Lord. We cut off in our own need and whine about the injustice we feel in our lives. Help us to place our trust in your mercy and your compassionate love. Forgive us and lift us from the deep morass and put us back on track. Give us confidence in your presence and your direction throughout our lives. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
And now, let us greet one another with the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with you.
May the peace of Christ be with you, Lord. May the peace of Christ be with you, Lord.
There's football. What other things? Soccer.
Volleyball.
That's right. Swimming. Yes. Dodgeball. Do you know I broke a toe one time playing dodgeball? We missed the ball and kicked each other. Anyway, the reason why I asked about that is because we have a special story about the Granite Falls football team. Now, Junior plays for the Granite Falls Junior High football team.
Wow.
And a week ago yesterday, they had a game and someone broke their arm.
Oh.
It wasn't the Granite Falls team, it was the other team. So the other team, they were feeling really low. But you know, that Granite Falls team felt very bad too. Because you don't play to break a bone, do you? So what to do? So some of the kids on the Granite Falls team came up with praying. And they all looked to Junior to pray. And Junior said, said he didn't know what to say. But he prayed anyway. And what I want you to know is that it doesn't matter what you say. You don't have to have glowing words. You don't have to have written down. God knows what's in your heart.
Amen.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we first lift up that football player that broke his arm. We ask you to help him heal. We thank you for young people who know what to do when somebody gets hurt. We thank you that you are a God that we can turn to. Help us to learn today what we will need to do tomorrow and the next week and the next years ahead. Help us to be your hands and feet wherever we are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Danielle. And now the youth can go to their classes. Give them a couple more minutes to get that sit. We have our scripture reading this morning. It is responsive. Please stand if you are ready. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 to 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing.
He told them, "You also go out to work like you did, and I will pay you whatever is right."
So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing.
About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing in the ground. He asked him, "Why are you standing here all day long doing nothing?"
"Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard."
When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and give them their wages. Begin with the last ones hired,
the workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received a denarius.
So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more, but each one of them also received the denarius.
When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner.
Those who were hired last were only 1 hour, they said. And you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day."
But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius?
Take your pay and go. I want to give you one who is hired last, the same as I gave you.
Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous?"
So the last will be first, and the first will be last.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Please be seated. Before we share the message from God, let us lift our brothers and sisters who are in need of God's comfort and healing grace. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, your blessings around in our lives, and we lift our voices in gratitude for this lovely gift from you. We also lift our voices as our hearts cry out our concerns for those who are ill, who mourn, who feel lost. We offer to you, Lord, our joys and concerns, so often intermingled in our lives. Be with each of us and for those whom we name with our voices and in our heart. We pray for caregivers and all those with declining health. rested for God, remembered their services and dedications when they were much younger and healthier. In your mercies, give them healing and strength, and keep them safe each day. Lord, we lift our children to you, young adult, youth, and younger children. Be gracious to them, and lift them in your visions and your plans for them. Guide and protect them in the world whenever you send them to fulfill your call. Help them to grow in spiritual strength and become better acquainted with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Teach them the everlasting truth that to Jesus be all glory and splendid honor, both now and forever. We lift the names of our brothers and sisters for healing. Cancer treatment for dog, healing for Craig's back pain, Angie's husband, John's liver issues, Lizzie's sister, Dolores, and Sylvia and George's grandson, and Micah for his stomach flu and ongoing allergy sensitivities. We also lift Joachim, Sylvia's brothers, his full recovery process. We pray for Lalita, who's having cold and resting at home. Bless her and bring healing to her, O God. We also lift Lalita's sisters, Shanta and Sandy's, their knee pains and overall health. And for all the others who struggle with health issues and difficult circumstances in life. Lord, we pray for the victims of the earthquake and flooding in Morocco and Libya. We pray for the prolonged war victims in Ukraine, and those who defend their homeland, and those who are forcefully sent to the battlefield. Every life is precious and belongs to God, the Creator. We rejoice together for Sylvia's good lab report to God, and we are thankful for your safeguard of Jeanette from a potential accident. We are thankful for the active invitations and the positive outcomes. Help us not to give up or fall into despair, but always trust the Lord and continue our missional call. Lord, you have heard our cries and our shouts of joy. Make your presence known to us through the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. This morning I'd like to share with you the sermon title is We All Get What We Don't Deserve. We All Get What We Don't Deserve. It's a sermon about the amazing grace of God. Plenty of people work hard, but never get what they feel they deserve. Plenty of people are incredibly decent human beings, but always seem to get the short end of the stick. How many of us as children were cautioned with the self-evident truth that life is not fair? It's a hard lesson, but it's one we all learned, usually before we get out of the kindergarten. As an adult, we are surrounded by evidence that life is not fair. You know, when my family lived in California, we lived in Anaheim, where I attended an Assemblies of God seminary. I worked hard and only earn enough to barely survive for a family of four. In my 20-year-old car, I drove past the multi-million-dollar homes with pristine lawns and ridiculously expensive sports cars parked in the driveway. I saw people throwing money around as if it were confetti, while others like me and my neighbors struggle to pay the utilities and keep food on the table and even a roof over their head. We see those who flaunt the law yet get off scot-free, and we see the others who are innocent yet are punished unjustly. Life just is not fair, and I cried out in my heart. Now, let's be honest. When we were reading the parable for this morning, did our heart leap for joy? Were we thrilled when we heard that the workers who work hard all day in the hot sun were going to get the same pay as those who worked only 1 hour? This parable runs against the grain of one of our most deeply cherished values, that the value of hard work and just the reward. The more you work and the more productive you are, the more you ought to get paid, right? I don't know how many people who disagree with that. Do you? And this is the complaint of the people in the parable who worked all day. Those who were hired last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day. Is God fair or unfair? This parable gave rise to one of the most primitive crises we had in childhood. When one sibling gets something that we want, and the one who feels cheated screams, "But that's not fair!" But before we dismiss the parable and put it back on the shelf marked Bible passages not to be taken seriously, let's consider the possibility that there's something to be learned here at all. And that what's going on in this parable is nothing less than a battle between human justice and God's justice. And a battle between God's will and our will. And that, even though we say we just want to get what we deserve, what we most want and need is something much, much greater. The story is told of the Yogi Berra, a professional baseball player who played 18 seasons with the New York Yankees. You know, when the Yankees were at their peak, you believe it or not, Yankees used to be a good team. I don't know about nowadays, but today. They were negotiating contracts for the next year, and a group of reporters interviewed the players as they came out of the owner's office. And one of them asked Yogi Berra about the term of his contract. Berra said, "I am going to play baseball again next year for the Yankees. And would you believe it? They're going to pay me besides." If the workers who work all day have this attitude about their work, they wouldn't have resented the people who got to work only 1 hour and paid equally. Another problem with that disgruntled workers in this parable is that they lack the healthy sense of gratitude. And think about it. Have you ever been out of work? I have for many years. Have you ever applied for a job and got turned down? That's not fun, is it? I vividly remember how grateful I was when I got a call offering me a job that I needed really badly. What happened to that feeling of gratitude was we were on the job for a while and the new wears off. Isn't that when we start to complain and find fault? Those who are grateful to be employed have a little to complain about. It's when gratitude gives away to the routine that we become disgruntled and start to envy those who seem to have it bad. There is something else about gratitude. It keeps us humble when we stop and consider those who are less fortunate. You know the old saying, I complain because I do not have shoes until I met someone who had no feet. The same holds true for those of us who are able to buy groceries and pay our bills. There are a lot of people in our community even who can't afford to do these things. The tangible proof is that the free little food pantry will run at the corner of the street. It runs to dry less than a half of a day after someone fills it with food. The more we realize how blessed we are, the more we are able to look upon the less fortunate with compassion rather than resentment. This brings up an interesting aspect of this parable to consider. Those who were hired to work at 5 o'clock had been left standing around all day worrying about how they were going to feed themselves and their families. Perhaps they weren't standing around because they didn't want to work, but because they were the least to fit to work. When you drive by like a Home Depot or Lowe's, you see early in the morning a group of people standing to get hired as a daily laborers, right? Perhaps they weren't standing because they didn't want to work, but people don't want them to come to work. These people who were standing in the marketplace doing nothing were day laborers. They work for a day and earn this enough money to buy food for the family. And the way they work is that the people gather in a certain place to hire themselves out for the day. Folks who need day laborers come by and pick up the people they need. When I was serving the other church in California, often when we had a project at church, I drove a church van and go to like a nearby Home Depot and hire a couple of people to work all day. And every time I start before this group of people, I only needed 2 or 3 and 10, 15 people all rush to the car and say, hire me, take me. I'm a good, I'm stronger, I'm a better worker. I feel really sorry not being able to ask all of them to come. I just have to pick whoever look more experienced or stronger. It's just the nature of how these things work. Invariably what happens is that the younger, stronger, and more aggressive people get hired first. By mid-morning, all the people left milling around are undesirables. Those who were too old, too frail, too crippled, or too mentally incompetent to be hired. In the parable for today, God's justice is that everyone got to work. Amen? And everyone was given the earnings they need to feed themselves and their families. not according to their abilities, their productivities, or how many hours they work, but enough to feed themselves and their families. This is God's justice. The unfairness of their differing hours of work was offset by the unfairness of their various strengths and abilities. And this is God's way of doing things. Not that we get what we deserve, but that we get what we need. Amen. But perhaps this parable is even a fairer still. Maybe there's another letter to all this. When reading this parable, most of us probably naturally think that it is a better deal to work 1 hour for a 4 days' wages than to work all day for the same amount. But those who have sent a zillion resumes, like myself did once, or filled out hundreds of job applications and are still waiting for someone to call, no otherwise. It's a soul killing to wait and wonder and hope. It is a soul killing to have our destiny controlled by someone else whose name that we don't know. It's a soul killing to wonder if we will be able to buy groceries for the dinner table. It's far better to sweat in the hot sun, securing the knowledge that we will be able to feed our families that night. I've spent the hardest 2 years exactly going through all the above tormenting experiences since my former employer, Lucent Tech, filed bankruptcy after the 9/11 terrorist attack. Since then, I got laid off along with the thousands of the other employees, and I instantly lost over $100,000 in company stock investment. Overnight, I became jobless and completely broke. And so, let's ask ourselves, is it better to live most of our lives without Christ, without faith, without prayer, without hope, and to pay the cost of discipleship only in our last days? To imagine that those who say yes to Christ on their deathbed have struck a better deal suggests that we don't really value our relationship with Christ, that we value the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow rather than the joy of knowing Jesus. Yes, the irony of this parable is that when it comes to experiencing God's grace, those who grasp it early in life or first are indeed the more blessed. Amen. How much greater gift is it to live a life in and with through Christ? How much better it is to live a life with hope and love from an early age than to realize you need Christ only on your deathbed after a lifetime of loneliness and despair? Isn't it wonderful that Christianity knows nothing of the concept of superiority? The word says you get what you deserve. In God's kingdom, we all get what we don't deserve. Amen. Again, though we all get what we need. Of course, in that parable, God is the landowner, and we are the people waiting to be hired. The idea of salvation coming to us free of charge, with no strings attached, and seem to go against every instinct we have. And that is because we live in a world of unfairness. grace, a world where life isn't fair. But God is fair. Amen? He loves us all equally. He searches each of us out, and He died for us all. So why does Jesus have this parable? If we look back at chapter 19, we will see that the disciples ask Jesus, who then can be saved? And Jesus answers, with humans this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. But many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. Again, this is not an unfair statement. If those people who are first and keep their gratitude throughout their life and become deeper in relationship with God, then of course their blessings will be better. But what happened to most of us? We lost the sense of gratitude and we become disgruntled and just feel that life is unfair. Compare yours and mine with others around us. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. God's grace is beyond what we can fathom. God's love is beyond our comprehension. Life is hard. It's unfair. It can be extremely cruel and unforgiving. But God is not like that. Isn't that a good news? Amen. If you are still standing around in the marketplace without Christ, He is still looking for workers in His vineyard. No matter your age or what you have done with your life, He wants you to come and be part of His kingdom. The work is not easy, but it is more rewarding than anything else in the entire universe. For God is generous and He loves you and me. I dream that one day we all stand before God and say together, "Thank you, Lord, for what you have done for us." Praise God and amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Help us not to judge your plan and your grace and your love interaction in our life with our human understanding. Father God, cover us even today with your grace and mercy, and broaden our perspective, our understanding to see who you are, so we can trust you and follow you more faithfully. Father God, we ask for our children. This word is just so cruel, and they are facing with a certain future and also a lot of weird and sickening ideas. Protect them and guide them properly, O God, and give them the double and triple faith and trust than of ours. Thank you, God, and we praise you for your love and grace. Amen. Let's pray for a few minutes in silence.
musical response, Steal Away to Jesus. Today is also the last day for September's Coins of Compassion for Hope Link, since today is the last Sunday of September. So don't forget to fill the little Coins of Compassion as you leave the church today. And Nellie Ann, I'm not trying to put you on the spot. Do you know what October's going to be? Is it World of... Okay. I think it's Hour of Sharing, but I'm not positive. We'll have that, of course, in the bulletin next. The rest of the notes in the announcements are our usual. Is there anything additional that anybody has for us today? It's first Sunday next month, a week, so don't forget that'll be our day to wear our red shirts. If there are no other announcements, will our ushers come forward?
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee.